Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Nicole Almond, president of Enactus Canada. And on behalf of our board of directors and national office, welcome to the Enactus final round of competition, proudly presented by Tim Hortons. Before we kick off the competition, our friends at Tim's would like to share a few words.
Hello, everyone. My name is Axel Schwan, president of Tim Hortons. On behalf of Tim Hortons, I'm delighted to welcome you to the 2020 Enactus final round of competition. We are so proud to partner with Enactus Canada to help shape future generations of entrepreneurial leaders who are passionate about changing our country and the world. As the official host of this afternoon's activities, Tim Hortons couldn't be more pleased to help bring together top leaders of today, our judges, and the leaders of tomorrow, all of you. Since 1964, Tim Hortons has been delivering high-quality products and services for our guests and communities through leadership, innovation, and partnership. Simply put, our vision is to be the quality leader in everything we do, and this includes making a true and meaningful difference in the communities where we serve, much like the Enactus Canada program. During the Enactus final round of competition, you will see exactly what I'm talking about as the students showcase how their community development projects are shaping the economic, social, and environmental landscape of Canada. Prepare to be inspired. So without further delay, let's begin the presentations. Good luck to everyone.
Thank you to Tim Hortons for supporting today's final round. This year, they wanted to make sure that not just the top teams were recognized, but also the top students. Community Service Leadership Gold and Silver recipients will be receiving a Tim Hortons gift card as a token of their appreciation for all that you do. Students, check your inboxes. It should be arriving via email today. Congratulations and thank you to all our Community Service Leadership Award recipients. Please join me in welcoming our first team from Wilfrid Laurier University Waterloo and their faculty advisor, Laura Allen.
This is not normal.
How are we going to get back to normal?
Normality as it was before.
Return to normal.
It is a new normal.
A new normal.
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 We do need to get back to normal, but what is that going to look like? The truth is, the normal that we're used to is still full of challenges. But today, with the world on pause, we are presented with an incredible opportunity to rethink what normal could look like. At Enactus Laurier, we dream of a better normal, one that is more sustainable and inclusive for everyone. And it all starts with this one plastic bottle.
In July 2017, I entered an IDEO challenge and decided to focus on the plastic that holds the products we use to stay clean. As it turns out, 8.2 billion bottles of shampoo, conditioner, and body wash end up in North American landfills every single year. And to produce these plastic bottles, it requires massive amounts of oil, water, and energy, and emits high levels of CO2. And only 10% of the liquid product is the actual active ingredient that you're using. The other 90% is just wasted water. The resources used to produce these products last year in North America alone could have been used to power 4,500 homes, provide clean water for 44,000 people, and take 280,000 cars off the road. That is the cost of our plastic packaging. That is the dirty side of soap.
Growing up, I always had a passion for environmental stewardship and met Marissa in a sustainability competition in second year. We discovered that only 1 in 5 people recycle their bathroom toiletries. The bottles that do make it to the blue bin are often still contaminated with leftover soap and therefore can't be recycled. They're sent to landfills or end up in our waterways. These bottles never fully degrade. They just break down into microplastics. In fact, reports show that we unknowingly consume 74,000 microplastic particles every year just because we eat fish, drink water, and breathe. This should not be normal.
To create a better normal, we need solutions that are more sustainable for the planet and more inclusive for everyone. My whole life, I've witnessed the resilience of my talented brother in pursuit of his goals, despite assumptions people may hold about a disability that he has.
I joined Enactus 3 years ago, inspired by the team's mission of reducing systemic barriers for individuals of diverse abilities. And this is where we met Khaled. Khaled is compassionate, hardworking, and his enthusiasm lights up any room he walks in. Khaled has a developmental disability, and like my brother and many others, the focus can often be on assumptions about what a person cannot do, rather than every person's unique abilities. In the Canadian labor force, as low as 31% of those with developmental disabilities are employed. This makes this group among the most excluded from our economy, and because of this, many individuals are financially dependent on others. Khaled is one of over 300,000 Canadians of diverse abilities who face unique challenges in pursuit of their lifelong goals.
If there's one goal that I have in life, it's to leave the world a little better than I found it. I constantly find myself asking how things could be better for both the planet and its people. Now, it's obvious that things need to be better for adults with developmental disabilities, but it's really impossible for any of us to truly understand what it would be like to face these challenges on a daily basis. To gain a greater understanding, we spoke with support workers, families, and adults of diverse abilities, and we found that there's a lack of inclusive work opportunities, and that both jobs and work environments are not designed in ways to allow individuals to excel. This should not be normal.
To build a better normal, a more sustainable and inclusive normal, we launched EarthSuds. It's shampoo without the bottle. We recognize that the best way to reduce plastic waste is to not produce plastic at all. From experiments in my backyard to drying out hand soap in the oven, we quickly realized this was no easy task. Fast forward 2 years, many bad hair days, and over 200 iterations later, we finally reached our defining pivot to tablets.
EarthSuds are single-use, dissolvable tablets, a shampoo, conditioner, and body wash. They're packaged in recyclable boxes and reusable shower cases, 100% plastic-free. When you crush, add water, and lather, they work like liquid products, but steam or water alone won't dissolve the tablets. They're vegan, cruelty-free, and our customers love that they're made from high-quality ingredients, like argan oil and botanical extracts.
I love them. I love them. I love everything about them. They're compact, they're easy to use, they're colorful, they smell good. Really, they make me happy.
Easy to use, simple, and you just can't get anything else like this.
EarthSuds will change what you believe hair and body care should look like, and it certainly won't change how your hair and skin feels if you're used to a premium experience.
As the only product of its kind, we filed a full utility patent on our unique water-resistant, yet fast-dissolving formula. And EarthSuds was recognized by National Geographic as one of the top 10 innovations in the world for solving our ocean's plastic crisis. And we're featured in this month's issue of National Geographic.
Reduce, reuse, recycle. Recycle is the worst option. Second best is reuse, and then reduce is the best. Your model basically reduces the need for plastic.
So the first thing that appealed to me about the EarthSuds innovation was to say, what if we just didn't have a bottle? It starts with materials innovation, but also a sensible approach to achieving that commercial viability.
We had an innovative product that solves a massive global problem. But one key question remained: who was going to produce these tablets?
We realized there was an opportunity to provide meaningful employment to individuals of diverse abilities, whose unique skill sets would help our business thrive. We worked with experts in special education and an occupational therapist to design a supported employment program. Our program uses a person-centered approach, working with employees to build up both independence in the role and transferable skills for future work opportunities, and has been recognized by Developmental Services Ontario.
In April of last year, we hired our very first two production employees, Gord and Stella, and this year we hired Drew, Khaled, Beth, Sam, Zarbian, and Freya. The impact this employment has had on our employees is difficult to put into words, so we thought we'd let them tell you about it themselves.
It feels pretty good to be able to do it by myself and understand a bit more.
How did it feel to have a paycheck coming in?
Oh, it felt really great.
Yeah.
I learned how to save. I learned a lot of important skills and how to focus and pay more attention. I started to show a lot more independent skills. I had a lot of fun making soaps and learning about entrepreneurial business.
It made me feel like I'm a very hardworking person and I accomplished getting a job at Laurier, and that I was getting experience in a manufacturing type job. I did pretty good at being able to save them the money that I earned.
EarthSuds makes me proud because I get to help the environment and make the soaps.
With our employees' help, we launched our consumer line just 7 months ago, and since then have sold to over 1,000 customers, bringing in over $40,000 in revenue. We currently sell through two main channels, direct-to-consumer through our e-commerce store and indirectly through 55 retailers across North America, including major players in the sustainability space such as Well.ca and Terra 20.
We sell packs of 30 tablets for $18 each, providing us with an average 78% gross margin. Halfway through the month of March, we were on track to triple our sales every month. And then life changed pretty quickly.
Schools and retail stores closed, events were canceled, and business became anything but usual. And like every person in the world right now, we were left in a state of uncertainty over when things would get back to normal.
But we saw this as an opportunity to create more positive impact. So we doubled down on our e-commerce channel and developed a powder hand soap to address the global shortage. As an essential business producing hygiene products, we secured a new facility and started up production again, albeit in smaller shifts and ensuring proper physical distancing. We also launched a buy one, give one campaign to empower customers, and as a result, have donated 4,700 Ersuds tablets to youth shelters and food banks in need.
This year, we spread the Ersuds story to 8.7 million people through news articles, Facebook ads, Instagram influencers, and we were featured on breakfast television. We raised $100,000 in non-equity funding, and were accepted into some of the most prestigious accelerators in the country.
Between our sales and funding, we brought in over $140,000 this year. We've sold over 70,000 tablets, which has allowed us to prevent over 16,000 bottles from ever needing to be created. And next year, that number will grow to 113,000 bottles, allowing us to prevent 2,300 liters of oil from being extracted from the ground, 233,000 liters of water from being wasted, and 16,000 pounds of CO2 from entering our ecosystems.
We employed 8 hardworking individuals and measured a 77% improvement in their workplace skills. And this coming year, we plan to hire 24 more individuals of diverse abilities to join the Ersuds team.
In the next 12 months, we're on track to generate $279,000 in revenue. But it's not just about the sales growth. It's about the potential global impact that Ersuds could have. We've already had retailers and distributors reach out from countries like China, Australia, Costa Rica, and France. And the channel opportunities are endless. Pretty soon, you could see Ersuds at your nearest spa, campsite, or hotel. What started as an idea to create shampoo without the bottle has evolved into a movement to provide equal employment opportunities for all and eliminate billions of plastic toiletry bottles worldwide.
At Enactus Lawyer, we're building a better normal that's more sustainable and inclusive through Ersuds. But that's just the start. While we have the honor of being our team's spokespeople today, there are another 167 dedicated Enactus Lawyer leaders who poured their hearts into our enterprises this year. Here's how they're working to build a better normal.
At Mighty Hawks, a better normal means an accessible one-on-one entrepreneurship and financial literacy education for adults of diverse abilities, unlike any other program in the region, enabling 112 talented individuals to pursue their creative ambitions.
At Pollination, a better normal means incorporating the pollinator habitat crisis into 7 elementary schools, empowering 850 students to be the leaders of tomorrow.
And this year, we started a new enterprise because we realized that while stopping the creation of new plastic solves the root cause of the problem, there are currently still 300 million tons of plastic waste added to our environment every year.
At Last 20, a better normal means upcycling plastic into pavement. We're replacing a portion of bitumen, one of the common binding agents in traditional pavement, with low-density polyethylene, one of the hardest plastics to recycle. We've generated $20,000 in grants and are planning to work with the City of Waterloo to upcycle 5 million plastic bags to build roads to a better normal. Today, the world is on pause. We have an opportunity. Now, more than ever before, to think about the kind of world that we want to live in.
As a global community, Enactus students from around the world are working to build a better normal every day because we believe that our generation collectively can and will solve today's greatest challenges.
At Enactus Lauré, we're building a better normal where everyone has equal opportunity to pursue their lifelong goals.
We're building a better normal for our planet where we don't pollute our oceans, land, and air. Just a package of product that's meant to keep us clean.
We all get to choose what this new normal is going to look like. So what does a better normal look like to you? Thank you.
Okay, Enactus Laurier, your first question. Can you explain how you plan to scale the business?
That's a great question. We're already scaling. Just last month, we moved into a new production facility that helped us to increase our production drastically. And on top of that, we plan on expanding even further with a contract manufacturer. We were talking about 50. We've narrowed that down to 5, and we expect to be in one by August, where they have a production capacity about 10,000 units per day. They do everything from sourcing the ingredients to packaging the product. The one thing that they don't do is fulfillment. So that gives us an opportunity to expand our work program as well. Because as our sales increase, there's going to be more orders to fulfill and more jobs there. So they're going to be focusing on fulfilling the orders.
The next question is, how did the team organize roles and responsibilities to achieve success?
We split our organization into kind of 4 main departments. We have sales, marketing, operations, and production. And under each different department, we have a VP that's running it. So really, we're running this as a real business. This is not just another school club to us. And we put basically every ounce of time outside of school into accelerating the growth of Ursuds and other businesses.
The next question is, there is a significant jump in your projections between this year and next. What is going to drive that?
So referring to the $279,000 in sales, and we actually think that this is a pretty conservative projection based off of the models that we've run. So currently this month, we've done about 7,000 in e-commerce sales. We think that could easily be up to an average of 10,000 of e-commerce sales across every month. So take that to about $120,000, maybe to $130,000 of e-commerce. We plan to be in, once the pandemic settles down, lots of retailers are hoping to work with us, and working with our distributors, we think that we can be in 320 retailers by next year. At an average order value of about $250, that would only mean 2 orders per retailer to achieve that other $150,000. And that's just talking about e-commerce and retail. We mentioned many different other channels that we're currently exploring, and so we think we can drastically increase that as $279,000, and we're excited to be back here, hopefully next year, with a much higher sales number.
Your next question is, do you see this moving to other products?
That's a great question. We've definitely thought about other products. I'll talk first about products within the same line. So we've currently have our product as one shampoo fits all as we can, but we're looking at incorporating new shampoos and conditioners for really, really kinky curls that need more moisture. That's the first kind of product development that we're doing. We've gotten a lot of requests from customers of different kinds of products that they want to see in a zero waste form that's similar to us, such as laundry detergent, toothpaste, mouthwash, shaving cream. So we're definitely thinking about those.
Thanks. Next question is, great incorporation of the current normal. When the new normal does come, have you explored partnering with hotels?
That's a great question, and it definitely is something that we've started to consider. The first thing that hotels wanted to see before they are ready to sign a long-term contract was more consumer traction and awareness. Over the last 7 months, that's something that we've been able to actually start to gain. And with that, we see the opportunity there in the future for sure.
Can you walk us through the cost model and margin on the business? They want to understand your margins and ability to self-fund your growth.
Certainly. So we sell a starter pack, which contains 15 tablets for $14. And the COGS on that is $3.35. We also sell refill packs of 30 tablets for $18, which has a COGS of $3.70. So we have a really competitive gross margin that is aligned and almost even better than the industry average. And so we're really using our profits to reinvest into the business and try to grow this, not only, you know, socially sustainable or environmentally sustainable, but also economically sustainable.
Another judge is wondering if you can tell them a little more about the 55 retailers that are carrying your product.
Certainly. So it's a range of retailers. We like to class them as healthy living stores. So these are stores that are really trying to take the next step on sustainable products. It's clearly an increasing trend in the market and something that consumers are looking for. And so we're not the only sustainable product in those stores. But by talking to some of these bigger retailers, in the presentation was mentioned, Well.ca is a huge one, Terra 20, but also those other 53 retailers. Really, they've told us that we're priced at the sweet spot for this category. And so that was really something that helped solidify that our price point actually wasn't too expensive. It was bang on.
Great. And then the kind of a follow-up fortuitously, is, are you experiencing any challenges getting a large retailer to sell your product to enable the scaling of the business and have an even greater impact?
The number one thing that retailers look for are sell-through rates. So we haven't had a ton of data to date to show that that's been strong. However, our biggest retailer did sign on in December. They already placed another order 2 months later. So that's a great sign for us that the sell-through rates are high, and we are constantly in communication with our retailers to try to push product as much as we could, as much as we can. Before the crisis, we were working with them to develop retail-specific informational cards on the shelves and really to understand our retail display. So this is something that we'll continue to encourage as we move forward and to try to keep our retail sell-through rates strong.
Great. What's the biggest challenge with the physical product?
Definitely. I think the biggest challenge that we've had this year is with the formula. So about this time last year, we had a finished product. And just about the beginning of November, that was when we actually launched our product for the first time and had people paying and buying it to use it. We care so much about customer feedback. So as soon as we launched that, we were getting all the customer feedback that we could. And people loved it. They loved the form. They loved everything about it. The one recurring piece of feedback that we wanted to improve on was that the conditioner was a bit stripping and it wasn't as moisturizing as they want it to be. So we took that as an opportunity to not only improve that product, but improve all of our products across the board in terms of quality. So we started incorporating things like argan oil, vitamin E, green tea extract, things that are the highest quality ingredients in the market, and getting our conditioner to that point where it is extremely moisturizing, extremely improved. And we just launched all that a month ago, and we've received amazing feedback since doing that.
Great. The next question is, will EarthSuds be an incorporated business or a team project going forward?
So EarthSuds is incorporated, but we operate, like, it's been built and operated through Enactus Laurier. So it will continue to work through Enactus Laurier, but it's incorporated by students, myself and Marissa.
Did you include CO2 emission reductions from transport and distribution emissions lower due to the light weight of the shampoo?
So that's currently not included in our CO2 reduction, but I can say that we definitely do have a lower CO2 impact from the transit of our product. Whether it's being delivered to your door or to a retailer, there's always going to be transportation there. And we have a lighter product and also a more compact product. So that means that it's actually 10 times lighter and more compact. So that means that there's going to be less CO2 emissions there in the transportation.
And with the opportunity as broad as it is, what criteria do you apply to ensure focus or success?
There's a multitude of criteria that we would apply to.
Your time has expired. Judges, please join me in thanking the team from Wilfrid Laurier University Waterloo.
Hello, my name is Destiny, and I've worked at Tim Hortons for 3.5 years.
Hey, how are you?
Good, thanks.
So you brew coffee every 20 minutes?
We brew our original blend coffee every 20 minutes to make sure it's fresh for every guest we serve.
Thank you very much.
Really? Every 20 minutes?
Day or night. I don't know of anyone else who does that, but you can really taste the difference. So it's always fresh. Always.
Please join me in welcoming the team from Brandon University and their faculty advisor, David Taylor.
What if at this moment 1 year ago, we told the world a dream of ours, a dream to completely eradicate the shortage of hygiene access in our city, a dream to address a social problem while simultaneously benefiting the environment? Imagine families in our community with free access to a basic hygiene product.
Imagine waste diverted from the landfill and converted to a basic product that many of us take for granted.
Imagine the development of revenue sources that will allow the project to become independently sustainable and expand its reach to other communities.
Let's jump to today, where in the last 3 months, COVID-19 has turned our world upside down, introduced us to social distancing, and where every major COVID website lists washing your hands regularly as step one in your own personal protection protocol. When the project started over a year ago, we referenced the World Health Organization and Canadian health bodies, whose guidance says it is hand washing with soap that provides the greatest safety against viruses and infections. Without proper access to soap, Canadians are 45% more likely to catch the common cold or influenza, and 20% more likely to develop intestinal problems. Since these individuals are at higher risk of infection, the risk of transmission throughout the community is also increased.
In the past year, Enactus Brandon has harnessed the power of social enterprise and innovation to empower, motivate, and help sustain our world. Today, we're going to share our story of how an idea turned into a plan, how a plan turned into a product, how that product created an impact, and how that impact is going to compound. This is a story of Renew Hygienics, an enterprise dedicated to waste reduction, accessible hygiene, and empowerment within our community.
Every year, hotels in Canada discard 180 million gently used soap bars into landfills, resulting in over 20 million pounds of carbon emissions wasted. Yet, the World Health Organization reports that there are hundreds of millions of people worldwide who lack access to basic hygiene and hygiene products. In our home of Brandon, 24 of the 26 hotels also simply discard their gently used soap products, between 10 to 15,000 pounds of soap being thrown away every year. Yet, there are over 1,100 families in our own community who cannot afford these basic hygiene items. While organizations like the Food Bank attempt to provide these items, they often fall short due to their dependency on inconsistent public donations. Further, when supplies are low, recipients will have to choose whether they need soap or another necessity, such as toothpaste or toilet paper. Given all of these facts, we tasked ourselves with developing a sustainable social enterprise focused on reducing the waste associated with hotel stays by providing these items a meaningful second life and ensuring all 1,100 food bank dependents in Brandon receive a bar of soap every month.
For this enterprise to be sustainable, we needed to establish a truly unique business model. First is our supply chain. We established partnerships with three local hotels and several Airbnbs, looking for ways to lower their environmental footprint by donating their discarded soaps and shampoos, meaning we are sourcing the bulk of our supply completely free, allowing us to keep our product costs down and focus our efforts on creating quality products by utilizing organic ingredients that you can recognize. In fact, in most of our bars, we incorporate an additional secondhand ingredient to further maintain our waste-conscious principles. Take our Pablo bar, for example. It uses secondhand coffee grounds sourced from community members who believe in our project and donate their K-cups. By using this quality ingredient, which has many skincare benefits, it allows us to recycle the plastic cup instead of the consumer sending it to the landfill. This helps reduce the product cost and expands our brand recognition by engaging community members.
Our nimble and scalable production process avoids big equipment and can be done in a small space. We needed a process that efficiently cleaned and sanitized the supply, but also broke it down for us to upcycle and rebrand the raw material into a bar that anyone would be happy to use. So, this is how the magic happens. The soap is taken through a full external cleanse. It is ground into fine pieces, then disinfected using heat and pressure. It is then melted down, quality organic ingredients are added, and finally it's remolded into our own brand new product. This is a zero waste production. For every pound of soap that goes into production, we get a pound out.
To meet our goal of eradicating the shortfall in access to quality hygiene product in our community, not once, but indefinitely, we recognized that we needed to generate revenue to pay our bills and scale production. Our one-for-one model, one bar of soap sold equals one bar donated, allows us to address the issues of social equity and sustainability. The bars cost between 50 cents and 82 cents to make, accounting for the donated bar. We sell the bars at renewhygienics.com for $5 per bar. With a profit margin averaging 85%, we have a lot of room for flexibility when it comes to introducing retailers and bulk distribution, all while being priced competitively against similar soap brands. All of this is done by a group of dedicated Enactus Brandon volunteers and one hired employee, from whom we also rent a basement production space. Here's what our employee Glenn has to say.
It's been good for me, both mentally and financially, and it's also created a little more stability in my life too, not having to worry about where the extra little money's coming from. It takes my mind off things too.
How do the bars smell?
Actually, they smell good. They do. They sure smell a lot better than the first ones we started making, I'll tell you that much.
So, this is what we do. But how far have we come in 1 year? Let's start here, the pillar of our business, our soap bar. This is what we first started with. It was a tangible good and it provided value. But this is where it is now. Through numerous iterations, we have created a product that we are pleased to donate to those in need and proud to present to consumers and prospective retailers. With a quality product in hand, we've approached new markets and expanded our streams of revenue in two different ways, which are already creating cash flows.
First, we started taking on events when requested, such as the February Brandon Chamber Commerce Luncheon, where the sale of our 250 soap bars were featured in gift bags. This allowed us to showcase our soap bars to 250 potential customers and business sponsors. In true entrepreneurial fashion, we capitalize on this opportunity by highlighting our ability to customize our soap product to potential businesses by imprinting their logo in the soap instead of ours. This effort led to our second new stream of revenue. We landed three businesses as clients who were looking to align themselves with a social and environmental initiative. They now purchase custom brand and soaps on an ongoing basis, which they give to their clients to show off their gratitude with a unique product that tells a story at an affordable price of $5.50 per bar.
Since beginning sales efforts at the start of February, we have generated over $1,250 without accounting for our retail clients.
And our biggest accomplishment, our scale and impact. Over the last year, we have diverted over 1,000 pounds of waste from the landfill and provided soap bars to over 1,000 local families who could not afford them. We did this all while providing an increase of 19% to Glenn's annual income.
So, where to now? What does the future look like? From day one, we've always said, we are not a soap company. We want to provide a whole line of hygiene and wellness products for consumers and those in need. With that, there are a number of improvements in store. Following a CBC radio interview last month, two local retailers have reached out asking if we would put our products in their store. We've officially come to terms and we will be launching these partnerships on May 31st. These are the first of many for us. We're actively entertaining prospective retailers and we plan to be in five different rural communities with products in one unique boutique shop in each. This will expand our sales and brand awareness while keeping shops incentivized to carry our product. Once COVID-19 restrictions are relaxed, we will roll out the Hotel Heroes program. This is a scalable revenue model where hotels make a small annual contribution and we provide them with marketing and promotional services, as well as collect their discarded soaps and shampoos. From featuring them on our social media and websites to providing in-room tent cards and digital certificates, the hotel will be able to highlight their corporate social responsibility to their guests. For us, this means more established partnerships and a way to be paid to source our supply. In addition, scalability will be marked by our expanded effort to market ourselves. We've just begun tapping into free forms of online marketing using promotional giveaways on social media that encourage following and engagement. Further, we will begin tapping into local social media influencers who fit well with our brand.
We also need to establish formal shipping logistics. We are currently limited to shipping locally only, and that significantly impacts our sales. We are in discussion with local couriers and shipping companies to determine our best way of moving forward. Ideally, we would continue with our low waste by only using secondhand boxes to ship while expanding our sales potential. Through increased revenue and cash flow, we will expand on our business by hiring an additional employee and increasing production through the acquisition of new equipment. Our landlord, Glenn, has given us the go-ahead to expand and rent out additional space, which will allow us the room to add new ventures while keeping all production in-house. By the end of summer 2020, we expect to be producing 1,000 bars per month and have one more part-time worker. This year has not been without problems. COVID-19 has had an enormous impact on all of our lives and especially on the hotel industry. This pandemic has opened our eyes to our reliance on our main supply source. Since no one is staying in hotels right now, our supply is down and we are tapping into our reserve supply to keep up with business. Because of this, we recognize that it would be of benefit for us to establish ways for everyone in our community to be a part of this enterprise. We are setting up donation bins around our city where people can drop off their used soap and we can take care of the rest. This would ultimately mean less waste is ending up in the landfill, and we are increasing the sustainability of our supply chain and sharing our mission.
The future is bright for our products. We currently have two brand new soap bars awaiting a summertime market release, which incorporate the zest of various fruits for exfoliative properties and natural aromas. Renew Hygienics, quality handcrafted soap for you, the environment, and someone in need.
But this isn't all we accomplished. Our team of just 28 members contributed over 2,900 hours and helped improve our immediate community with three additional projects. With the WISE project, we worked extensively with 95 new immigrants to improve their confidence and competence in the Canadian financial system through a series of interrelated workshops. With our project Green Futures, our community gardens grew over 5,000 pounds of fresh produce for local income families, generating an economic impact of over $21,000.
With our tax program, we filed over 85 tax returns for free for Brandon University students, amounting to over $100,000 in returns. This year, we identified problems and created innovative solutions to empower, motivate, and help sustain our world. We are Enactus Brandon.
Okay, so Enactus Brandon, let's start just to the judges, a reminder to put your question and answer into the Q&A function, not the chat. But I will start with the first question from Maya Pearson. How automated is the production process and how quickly can you scale?
Our bars of soap are handmade and our customers love it. Our processes are very standardized and our employees and volunteers are putting through a rigorous training process so that they understand these processes and it's easy for them to learn. We have a ton of capacity with our current production. Therefore, we will be able to scale with our current production processes.
Great. How did you organize roles and responsibilities to achieve success?
Yeah, so our production is run. We have a manager that kind of oversees all productions and he kind of organizes who's coming in to make soaps, et cetera. And then we have different marketing positions, et cetera, that are overseen by our manager.
Next question is from Vittoria Varelli at Sobeys. In addition to hotels, which channels will you target for expansion? Do you plan to limit expansion to Canada only?
Like, we don't really have like any limitations in the future. We want to make sure that we have everything going right in our local community, that we're meeting all of our local community's needs, and that if we do expand to other countries in the future when that does happen, that we're meeting the needs of the communities that we're in there as well.
Great. Jeff Wright from Canadian Western Bank is asking, many hotel chains are changing the way they provide soap and shampoo and not providing individual bars or bottles, moving to bulk dispensers. How will this trend impact your business model?
So right now, we do have the bar soaps. We're looking into expanding into other products as well, like the shampoos and things like that. So as long as there is research development into new opportunities there, right now bars of soap are going to be happening still for the foreseeable future. If things do change, then we will be able to change with that.
Great. A couple judges, Julia Deans from Habitat for Humanity and Mark Lippman from Lloyd's Canada, have asked if hotels, if you've considered bringing hotels on as clients as opposed to just suppliers.
Yeah, for sure. In the future, we're looking at creating bigger partnerships with our hotels. For example, with our Hotels Hero program that we're planning to roll out, this will allow us to partner with the hotels and provide them with various marketing services, such as the use of our Renew Hygienics logo. We provide marketing services for them, as well as in-room temp cards that outline their corporate social responsibility. So yes, we definitely want to work with these hotels more in the future to establish larger partnerships with them and find new ways to work together.
What's been your largest, Kevin Murphy from BIC has asked, what has been your largest challenge to date and what have you learned from it?
Our biggest challenge to date has definitely been sourcing our supply during COVID. But it has been a really good learning experience for us. We realized that we did rely too heavily on hotels for sourcing our supply. Therefore, we have set up donation bins around the city so that we can source our supply from multiple sources, as well as we do keep a reserve supply of 3 months so that we've been able to keep up with production despite having our supply go down during COVID.
Alicia Calvert from EY has asked, how can you control quality when the blend of soap you receive as an input can vary?
Yeah, for sure. Quality is very important to us, and that's why we keep all production in-house. And like I said earlier, we have very standardized processes that are rigorously taught into all of our employees and volunteers. We keep quality at the center of our operations, and every bar of soap that comes out is of the utmost quality.
Cameron Laker from Minefield has asked, what's the biggest barrier for customers to purchase and how can you overcome that?
So right now the biggest barrier for customers is has been our lack of presence in retail stores, but we're now making partnerships and getting our soaps into brick and mortar stores so they can buy it from there. And then everyone is still able to buy it online as they have before.
Just to add to that as well, as we mentioned in our presentation, we were looking for shipping logistics, but we have solved that issue and we now have a membership with Canada Post. And with this business account, we are able to ship Canada-wide, expanding our customer base.
Rob Henderson from Eureka has asked, with regards to your tax clinic, why did you choose to offer the service for free when you're giving so much value?
So we offer it for free because a lot of our clients are international students who really don't have very much money. We want to give as much value as we can.
Aaron Oliver from Modern Niagara asks, do you know the type of ingredients that come from the salvaged products so you can ensure that hypoallergenic issues don't arise with the second user?
Yeah, absolutely. We have a thorough understanding of all of the ingredients that go into our soap products and that we source from hotels. So therefore, we're able to keep track of things such as allergens to make sure that all of our customers have a soap bar that they feel confident using.
The next question is from Catherine Coston at Dow Canada. Have you estimated supply chain costs if you want to expand and get soaps from hotels further away from your current location?
As we expand, we're going to set hubs up in different facilities across Canada. So this will allow us to keep some of those costs down as this supply is close to all of our facilities. So that's kind of our plan as we expand to keep those costs down.
Carolyn Barham from Kelwood Enterprises asks, you add organic ingredients to the soap. What are they and how do you source those?
Absolutely. So we use various different organic ingredients. For example, we use honey. This is sourced from a local honey farm that is just outside of Brandon. We also use reuse Keurig pods. So we use the coffee grounds from there as well. So we collect from community members across Brandon, which is also a good opportunity for us. And we use things like oat milk, etc. So all of our ingredients are really quality ingredients that add to the quality of our soap.
Perfect. The next question is from Maya Pearson at North Strategic. How competitive is the pricing for hotels and Airbnb? Do you have a different price than the $5 per bar for hotels? I think she's asking if there's a different price for hotels versus
right now, it's all the same price for everybody. Usually like with our corporate clients who are getting the custom soaps, we like charge more for those so that we can bring more money into the production process.
And someone was saying, Stephen Sage from Kruger Products asked, I don't believe you spoke to what happens with the bottles after you've extracted the product. Do you clean and recycle?
So with our soap bars, we're actually collecting just soap bars.
Your time has expired. Judges, please join me in thanking the team from Brandon University and their faculty advisor, Dave Taylor.
My name is Kevin, and I've worked for Tim's for 22 years. We've had the same blend since 1964.
Wow.
It's what makes the Tim's taste so unique.
Are you the only one who knows the secret recipe?
Only three people in the world know the secret recipe, including me.
So you protect the secret recipe here?
Right here in our Tim Hortons roastery.
Please join me in welcoming the team from Lambton College and their faculty advisor, John Milos.
We have a story to tell you.
A story of success.
A story of people's hopes and dreams.
A story that started with our first trip to Zambia back in 2012.
During our needs assessment, we met with farmers,
school leaders,
village elders,
and tribal headmen.
And we heard the same key themes.
We can't feed ourselves.
We don't have clean drinking water.
We need more ways to make money.
And now we want to show you the success of transferring knowledge by training trainers.
We want to show you the results when a project is scaled.
We want to show you how empowered farmers are changing their lives through entrepreneurship.
Our first goal was to help them achieve food security.
To create food security, we teach farmers no-till farming.
No-till farming is a way of growing crops without disturbing the soil through plowing.
It keeps water and nutrients in the soil.
We teach proper seed planting depth, seed spacing, and row spacing, all key principles of no-till farming that create a vast increase in crop production.
To make our work scalable and sustainable, we had to transfer our knowledge to the farmers, and our focus has been on training Zambian trainers.
Before our team taught no-till farming, Zambian farmers had yields of 27 50-kilogram bags of corn.
This year, because of no-till farming, they are now harvesting an average of 145 bags per hectare.
Profit has increased from an average of $300 per hectare to an average of $1,400 this year.
That's a 5.3 times increase in yield and 4.9 times increase in profits.
So how many farmers did we train this year? Zero.
That's right. We didn't train a single farmer this year.
For 8 years, we have worked towards this moment, a fully scaled and sustained project with over 500 trainers trained.
This is the year after 30 trips to Zambia, we have passed full control of our farming project over to the Zambians.
This is the year we have been working towards for 8 years.
And the Zambians are ready to take full ownership.
On their own, they added 41,500 new farmers to the project this year.
That's 41,500 farmers earning $1,400 per hectare.
That's 41,500 farmers earning almost $61 million on their own.
With food security achieved, our farmers were ready to tackle building their economy using the business development skills we taught them.
Farmers are not getting value for their crops, and too often their crops are exported to other countries.
We wanted to stop this, and so we taught farmers how to add value to the raw materials they are growing.
We taught them how to add value so they could capture all or part of the value chain, dramatically increasing their profits.
This past summer, we expanded our food production business, building two new facilities that process the corn using a hammer mill and a huller.
We trained an additional 51 new entrepreneurs how to set up collection depots, enabling them to buy corn from local farmers.
The corn is then processed to make samp and millymeal, both food staples in Zambia.
These value-added products are then sold back into the community for consumption.
On average, each of the 51 small businesses is selling 1,150 kilogram bags at an average profit of $6.95 per bag.
That's just under $7,800 profit per entrepreneur in communities that typically survive on less than $1 per day.
To add context to what $7,800 means to a farmer, tuition at school costs $650 per year for 6 kids.
A sturdy bicycle is $90.
And a 3-bedroom home can be built for $6,000.
$7,800 goes a long way in Zambia.
We also started another business last summer.
95% of Zambian cotton is exported to other countries.
To stop this, we had farmers build a small cotton ginnery, spinning cotton into yarn.
41 farmers are now spinning their own cotton into yarn instead of exporting it.
Raw cotton is sold for 36 cents per pound, but by adding value, farmers are now selling yarn for 90 cents per pound.
More than doubling their revenue.
This year, 122,000 pounds of yarn has been sold,
increasing revenue to $110,000 while stopping raw cotton exports.
Our farmers, on their own, saved their money to build these projects.
And they are so proud.
Do you know how it is like to be poor? Do you know how it feels that you live without food? Do you know how it is that you live without hope? Thanks to the Enactus Lambton, who gave us the knowledge that we are able now to have hope, dignity, and have food on our table. We are able to feed our families. We are able to grow the economy. That was the dream we were scared of, but now we are achieving it. Thanks up to Lambton.
We have been invited in September to present our work to the United Nations.
We hope to inspire more people and give them hope.
And show them they can also bring their dreams to life.
Now it's time to expand.
It's time for a new challenge.
It is time to bring our project home.
Canada has over 600 First Nations, representing more than 1.3 million people.
People living in First Nations struggle with many of the same challenges as our friends in Zambia.
To help First Nations with these challenges, we launched Project One Circle in July.
We conducted needs assessments in many First Nations,
meeting with band members, hereditary leaders, community elders, elected chiefs, and council.
We asked a lot of questions, and we learned.
We listened, and then together we built programs to address their goals.
We are extremely honored that we are already working with 16 First Nations.
And incredibly, 14 of the 16 First Nations proactively contacted us first.
Let us take you through some of the exciting projects already underway.
First Nations need the knowledge and skills to build their own economies.
We decided to fill this gap by building entrepreneurial capacity.
We teach entrepreneurship and business financial literacy.
Already, 46 entrepreneurs in multiple First Nations have been trained.
To ensure lasting sustainability and scalability, we are also training First Nations trainers.
We wrote the book for this project, and I mean, we literally wrote the book.
We spent last summer writing our own entrepreneurship textbook, and it is about to be published and will be available to anyone for free on the Ontario Colleges portal.
Here are just a few of our success stories from the 46 entrepreneurs we trained this year.
This is Will Paul from Lytton First Nation in British Columbia. Will has an amazing spice called Fear the Heat that he grows, packages, and sells.
Working with us, Will has improved his production, supply chain, marketing, and sales strategies.
And Will has quintupled his production and profits.
This is Deborah Moccasin from Whitecap Dakota First Nation in Saskatchewan.
Deborah stands 5 feet tall, and so the name of her business is One Tiny Moccasin.
Deborah makes First Nations clothing, and we are helping Deborah expand into new markets, increasing her sales and revenue.
But what we really want to highlight is Deborah's giving spirit.
Deborah decided to make face masks for first responders.
She has already produced 212 masks.
And she is giving them away for free.
This is the spirit of Enactus at its best.
The final project we would like to highlight today is the coolest project we have ever developed.
During our needs assessment conducted with 7 First Nations near Saskatoon, we uncovered a common goal shared among all 7 nations.
They want to repopulate bison on the plains of Saskatchewan.
Bison are an important symbol to First Nations and an important connection First Nations people have to their land.
Bison sustained a way of life for First Nation people for thousands of years.
They were a main food source, their hides used for teepees and clothing, and their bones were fashioned into tools.
We have developed developed a plan to begin returning bison to the plains,
re-establishing traditional food security while restoring their cultural importance to First Nation people.
We also learned global demand for commercial production of bison is currently 100% higher than supply.
There is a tremendous demand for bison products, and this presents an opportunity to create new businesses and badly needed employment within First Nations.
At one time, 30 to 60 million bison grazed across open grasslands, and they were the key in maintaining prairie ecosystems.
By 1888, none were left.
And our prairies are one of the world's most endangered habitats, disappearing off the face of the earth faster than the Amazon rainforest and the Great Barrier Reef.
More than 70% of Canada's prairie grasslands are gone.
The return of bison will play a critical role in improving our environment.
They are critical in regenerating vegetation.
As bison forage, they aerate the soil with their hooves,
dispersing the seeds of grasses, plants, and wildflowers, creating a diverse mosaic of habitats which are critical to the survival of countless wildlife species.
Many of which have already declined significantly in number or have already disappeared.
Culturally and economically, our bison project is about to make a huge impact on the prairies.
We are proud of the projects we have launched in First Nations.
And Project One Circle continues to expand into more First Nations.
At times, our work is daunting,
but the impact we are creating keeps us motivated.
And we have worked very hard at developing meaningful relationships.
A lot of times when a consultant comes into an Indigenous community, the relationship is purely transactional. We give them some money, they turn around and give us a strategic plan or some type of report. There's very little substance to the relationship that's there, if there is any relationship at all. The team at Enactus Lambton has a refreshing approach to community engagement, and it really is a masterclass in how consultation with Indigenous communities should be done. In the short time that they've been working with our communities, we've built meaningful friendships. We've sat around the table and shared meals while we laughed. We've cried healing tears together. And most importantly, they've planted seeds of hope for our community's futures. The team at Enactus Lambton really proves that the word reconciliation can be more than just a buzzword. They are reconciliation in action.
We're honored to be a small part of reconciliation.
Many moments of the past create actions of the future.
Nothing can change history, but through reconciliation built on understanding, trust, and commitment, our team can be a small part in changing the future.
We are Enactus Lambton.
Thank you, Lambton. So we'll get started with the questions. Our first question is from Deanne Sauvé at the Jean Sauvé Foundation. How will you export and adapt the program to other countries? And have you found ways to optimize and accelerate the teaching of new trainers?
Hi, Nicole. We actually are on a call tomorrow with the Netherlands to expand our project One Seed from Africa to there. So it's an Enactus team from the Netherlands that reached out to us looking to expand.
Wanda Randall from Canon Canada is asking, how did you raise funding to start the Zambian project?
Our students on our own actually pay their way to go to Zambia. So we pay out of pocket. I personally went to Zambia and I fundraised to be able to go to that. And anything we win when it comes to donations or through Enactus, it all goes to projects on the ground. The administration costs are covered by our college.
David Henderson from XPV Water Partners has asked, did you train the Zambian entrepreneurs, or did that fall under the train the trainer approach?
We train the Zambian entrepreneurs. It's separate from the trainers, the farming trainers that were trained.
Carrie Patterson from We Charity has asked, how do you choose and partner with the Indigenous communities, and what's the long-term plan on partnerships to ensure long-term sustainability in these communities?
So as we said in the video, we actually were contacted proactively by 14 of the nations. The work we were doing was getting buzz within the nations, and they came to us first. And just through that word of the mouth, we were able to expand that program and continue. We actually have dozens of First Nations waiting for us. And through this process of getting used to COVID, we were able to connect with a new nation and just now establishing how we're going to do this virtually. But it actually allows us to have a deeper connection with them, because instead of traveling there and seeing them once a month, we could meet weekly or bi-weekly or twice during the week, however they want to do it, and establish that connection. And we will also expand through our train the trainer model.
Great. Our next question is from Susan O'Brien at Canadian Tire Corporation. With One Circle, it's multiple projects that are quite different in nature. What's the repeatable capability that will create the same success that you had in Zambia?
The repeated capability will be through the entrepreneurship training, as entrepreneurship is the core with everything we do and the core that we see within the First Nations, as well as that train the trainer aspect, making sure the project is scalable and sustainable through that transfer of knowledge. And we also train entrepreneurship trainers.
Great. Mark Lippman from Lloyd's Canada is asking, is the Prairies Bison Project a sustainable business venture? Could you provide some more details?
Yeah, absolutely. So that's a project that all seven of the nations that work within the Saskatoon Tribal Council have asked for. They want to raise bison individually for cultural purposes, but also for a business venture. So they want to work together to bring their herds together and utilize the entire bison for the meat to the hides and export the products. There's a big market in the United States for bison meat, and they want to capture that market.
Great. Aaron Oliver from Modern Niagara has asked, corn and cotton are some of the most energy and water demanding crops. Do you intend to diversify and rotate crops within your project in Zambia?
Yeah, we are crop rotating now. We continue to do that in Zambia.
Great. Kim Hallwood from HSBC Bank Canada asks, for the Zambia project, will you maintain any oversight or continue to be involved in the project moving forward?
Absolutely. We still go four times a year. Because we have handed off the farming program, we are now able to focus more on the business development and building those individual entrepreneurs' business.
Jamie Mackay from Align asks, as a multi-year project that achieved impressive results this year, how can you help us understand what was accomplished this year and how much of that can be credited to effort and innovations this year, and how much was building on the impressive results and foundation of previous years?
Yeah, so this year we were able to expand those farmers' businesses. That was our big goal this year, along with transferring that farming program off to them. We've been building towards the scalability and sustainability of that project for the past 8 years. And to be able to hand over that piece and have our farmers, our 500 farmers, train 41,500 new farmers was a huge aspect. And then continue to expand those businesses of existing entrepreneurs. And we also did launch 42 new businesses this year.
Jeff Wright from Canadian Western Bank asks, what did your team do outside of your trips to Zambia to drive this effort? For example, when you were back at home?
Oh, absolutely. We're in constant contact with the Zambians through WhatsApp. We are having them send us pictures in any way we can support them. We're texting every single day.
Catherine Costin from Dow Canada asks, have you been facing language and cultural challenges, and how are you addressing those?
Absolutely. Obviously, our biggest challenge is building trust and establishing that trust. Anytime we go into a community, whether it's through the Zambian project or a project with the First Nations, it's building that trust. They have had multiple people come in and make promises within that community and never follow through. So we have to establish that trust. And we've done that in a few ways. We've done that through obviously showing them the value. A great example of that is in Zambia, them seeing the growth of their project year over year. And in the First Nations, we make an acknowledgement when we go into the communities and we talk about the history and we want to learn about their community and their history. And again, appearing in those communities. We've made over 50 trips to First Nations in the last 6 months. And we want to be able to connect with them in a way that they feel valued. And that's also by listening to their needs and building programs with them.
Great. Mark Lippman from Lloyd's Canada asks, it appears the project in Zambia has matured. Is there more for you to do there, or are you finished formally?
Yeah, we're going to continue that project through the economic development piece of it.
David Henderson from XPV Water Partners asks, what lessons are you applying from one seed to one circle?
The biggest lesson we're applying is that train-the-trainer model, making sure that it's scalable and sustainable through transferring the knowledge. Also, we're taking that entrepreneurship. The core piece of our program is through entrepreneurship and making sure that they're proficient in entrepreneurship in any way they can be.
Great. Julia Deans from Habitat for Humanity asks, with one circle, do you see involving other entrepreneurial organizations becoming partners to help these entrepreneurs move forward, or will you stay involved?
Yeah, absolutely. We're always willing to talk to new partners. We actually do have some work with an entrepreneurial organization that they help us connect, and we draw on their expertise whenever we need it.
Brent Twist asks, Project One Circle seems much more complex to apply the train-the-trainer philosophy to. Can you comment on how you plan to scale?
Absolutely. So whenever we go into a community, we identify trainers, usually within the first two meetings, and we start to train them every time we go in there. We get them comfortable with our material, and we have them sit
in. Your presentation time has expired. Judges, please join me in thanking the team from Lambton College.
My name is John, and I've worked at the Tim Hortons Roastery for 9 years. Most of the time, I'm cupping coffee. Do 94. We taste over 300 cups of coffee each day, and that's how we ensure that we have Canada's greatest cup of coffee.
300 cups a day.
Do 98.
How's your sleep?
I don't struggle, I sleep well.
Please join me in welcoming the team from St. Mary's University and their faculty advisors, Michael Sanderson and Jason Turner.
Needs in the world, across the globe. There are needs in Canada, there are needs in Nova Scotia, there are needs in Halifax. And Square Roots is taking one of those challenges and making a real difference.
Hello, I'm Hannah from Enactus St. Mary's, and today I'm so excited to share our solution to the global issue of food waste. This solution is Square Roots. Since launching in 2016, it has grown to encompass everything we do, creating a network, building connections, solving problems, and more recently, overcoming crisis with action. Since food waste is a problem that affects us all in different ways, we expanded beyond the walls of our university to uplift the lives of those who need it the most. And all of it started with a simple idea. Square Roots is a social enterprise that reduces food waste by finding innovative ways to keep food out of landfills and in the supply chain. We have three business units. The first, Square Roots Bundle, partners with farmers to repurpose cosmetically imperfect fruits and vegetables. We source the second's produce from local farmers and then deliver it on a monthly basis to our network of community partners. The fruits and vegetables are sorted into 10-pound bundles and sold at two price points. $10 for those who can afford it, and $5 for those who can't. No questions asked. The second, Square Roots Products, partners with businesses to turn food waste into creative and fun products. And the third, Square Roots Token, partners with restaurants to turn their daily food waste into profit. Restaurants typically prepare more food than they sell, and at the end of the day, all of their unsold food is simply discarded. Through the token program, we take perfectly good meals that didn't get sold during the day and offer them to hungry people in exchange for a Square Roots token. Tokens are sold for $5 each, $2.50 of which goes directly back to the restaurant. Together, these business units reduce over 93,000 pounds of the 1.3 billion tons of global food wasted each year. Square Roots solves problems in our local community and grows relationships across the globe. I'll break it down a little further. Square Roots Bundle is delivering healthy, fresh produce within communities. The objective is to reduce food insecurity and to help individuals without access to affordable, healthy, and fresh food. We operate in 13 communities and are always looking for ways to expand our impact. For example, recognizing that household food insecurity in Canada affects 1 in 6 children under 18, this year we established the Square Roots School Program. Our initial partner in this program is Inglis Street Elementary School, located in Halifax, Nova Scotia.
We decided that at the school level, it was something that we really wanted to support for the growth of our school community. And the Square Roots organization handled so much of the backside work, the paperwork and those things and the deliveries. So it just worked out really well as a partnership to create accessibility for fresh food for the families in our school.
Token is finding new customers for food that a restaurant would normally throw away. We increase restaurants' revenue while helping people in need. Square Roots Products is about building awareness. We want to get people involved in the reduction of food waste. We want to introduce a creative way to reduce waste. We partner with organizations and help them create products made from Seconds Produce. We then promote the product and its message. We have worked with diverse companies from craft breweries to dog food companies. Although the business units are different, they have a lot of similarities. Here are the themes that exist across all of them. Partnerships. All of the business units in Square Roots rely on strong partnerships. Bundle works with community champions who run their own businesses.
I think one of the keys of our success is that we have a huge number of volunteers and partners and allies in the community that help make this happen. Square Roots is critically important because you really are getting a lot of value from one simple task.
Our partners come from all walks of life, all ages.
I started my Square Roots business journey when I was 11. Some of the things I've improved while doing Square Roots are my social skills. I've also learned how to do a balance sheet for both of our outlets.
These partnerships have an impact. This year, in Square Roots Bundle, we partnered with a new local food delivery startup called Coria to provide free door-to-door delivery of our bundles throughout the greater Halifax area. Building partnerships through Square Roots products has allowed us to expand our offering. We started out with the carrot beer and dog food, but this year we have grown so much. MetroWorks, an organization that supports people with barriers to employment, partnered with us to make a carrot cake and apple squares through their bakery business. Now, carrot beer was cool. What about turnip juice?
At first, we were like, will people buy a drink that's turnip? And literally, we sampled it for a couple days, and the minute somebody drank it, they were like, I need to have this. So it was a lovely drink, and yeah, we sold out of it every time we made it.
Our partners share our values and have a passion for giving back. One of our newest token partners, Shivani's Kitchen, is so passionate about the program that she wants to host cooking classes for students. It's also no surprise that our first ever token partner, Basha, recently made headlines by offering free meals to those in need during the pandemic. The next element that ties these business units together is scalability. We build models that can not only grow, but can easily be replicated globally. Square Roots Bundle decided to expand operations last year to have an even bigger impact. Our first ever out-of-province franchise operates in Mississauga, Ontario, and has been a huge success.
We're in 3 different cities right now that span about 45 minutes apart from each other, but the need is very similar. We've had people come back to us and say, it's amazing to be able to afford fruits and vegetables for my family and not provide them something from a can. It impacts the next generation of people who are going to be buying in the grocery stores.
Based on the success of our first franchise, the Bundle program set out to create its first international hub. We partnered with Enactus students at the University of Limerick to launch Square Roots Ireland.
You need a fantastic team behind a project for it to work. I know just from the last few months of having dealt with Hannah and all the rest of the team in Enactus St. Mary's, It's really fantastic to see that students, not just here in Ireland, but across the world and in Canada as well, it's fantastic to see that there's a group of students that are so dedicated to giving back and helping their communities and helping the environment. So I suppose going forward from that, obviously, with a great team comes a great project, and with a great project comes great results. So I'm delighted to say that we are partnered with Enactus St. Mary's and with Square Roots, and couldn't be happier.
Following the franchise approach, Square Roots products provided advice and support to Enactus students from the University of Nottingham in the UK to help them launch their own beer brewed from leftover bread. Not to be outdone, the Square Roots Token Program partnered with the Enactus team at Medicine Hat College in Alberta to support the launch of their own hub. Our franchise package includes training, support, and funding. We invest in the franchise to help them get started. Whether this is traveling to a new location to support the launch, providing 1,000 pounds of free produce to give away for a bundle event, or providing tokens needed for a new hub, our team invests up to $5,000 into each new franchise. Scalability isn't always about franchising. It's also about examining our model to innovate and grow. We hired 3 Enactus St. Mary's alumni to make the token program digital. The new digital platform allows the sale, redemption, and storage of tokens digitally. The final pillar that connects all of these business units is adaptability. You have to be ready for changes in the market and adjust when needed. This has never been more important than right now.
We are implementing the Quarantine Act to keep all Canadians safe.
When all we have to do is stay the blazes home.
One thing is clear, we can only overcome COVID-19 if we take action together as a global community.
As we all know, everything changed in March. How can you launch a token platform when restaurants are closing? How do you make products when no one is producing? For Enactus St. Mary's, instead of focusing on what we lost, we decided to focus on what we could create. Now is the time that people need fresh produce more than ever. We have diverted all of our team resources to the Square Roots Bundle Program and to making sure that the most vulnerable in our communities have access to food. Led by our community champions, Square Roots has become a free food delivery program. Funded by existing cash reserves and community donations, we launched a program that with corporate partnerships, we deliver, give away, and sort free 10-pound bundles to those in need. Before the crisis, Bundle did a monthly delivery of about 5,000 pounds. We are now delivering that same amount weekly. Enactus St. Mary's has had unprecedented success this year. Our businesses have franchised across Canada and around the globe. We have kept close to 100,000 pounds of food waste in the supply chain. We have generated over $619,000 in revenue, provided over 80,000 meals, and invested over $230,000 into the over 11,000 people we have impacted this year. It really has been a year that we will never forget. It starts with our team members and their tireless effort, the support we get from our university and alumni. It is the community members, the restaurant owners, the organizations, the other teams in the Enactus community. Most importantly, it is the people we impact. We pivoted, seeing the pandemic as a challenge, not a barrier. An opportunity, not a threat. Bringing communities together while staying apart. We are Enactus St. Mary's. Local passion, global impact.
Thank you, St. Mary's. We will get started with the questions. Our first question is from Susan O'Brien at Canadian Tire, who's asking, can you explain a little more about how the franchise model works?
So our franchise model is a little different for the three pillars, but I'm just going to go off of, like, we're talking about Square Roots Bundle here, because I know that one has a lot of franchises. So within Halifax, Nova Scotia, how we build the franchises is that we act as, like, the source for the food. So we find all the seconds produce, and then once they become a part of our network, We can either send it to them in bulk to sort their own way, or sometimes we'll sort it for them. So Susie, for example, she's one of our favorite community managers, even though we love them all. She just prefers to deliver 30 bundles to community members she knows are in need. So that's how she does it, but everyone does it a little differently.
Great, thanks. Catherine Costin from Dow Canada is asking, do you have enough customers buying $10 bundles instead of the $5 ones to have a sustainable business model?
We actually do. So it depends on our location, the popularity of each pricing option. However, we do have a one-to-one sales ratio. So overall, the sale of $10 bundles does subsidize the cost of the $5 ones.
Great, thanks. Rob Henderson from Eureka is asking, what's your expected return on the $5,000 invested in new franchises? And how do you decide if you should proceed with a franchisee?
So for the return right now, we actually kind of let them have freedom when it comes to what their returns are. So this year, I'll just use Ming as an example because Ming was our very first out of province hub. So in Ontario, she launched a location where she sources all of her produce and she organizes everything around it and we act as support. So we don't really, we're not looking for a return from her. We're looking to share our mission through her. But this year she's generated, I believe, around $13,000 in revenue.
And once again, we are a community interest company. So that means every single, all the profits, all the revenues we make, all go back into Square Roots, into furthering our cause and into further into bettering the communities all around us.
Great, thanks. Karen Grieve-Young from Futurepreneur Canada is asking, how have your restaurant partnerships changed with the COVID-19 closures?
That's a good question. So our partnerships have still remained. Of course, certain restaurants have had to close down for a bit. But so that's why we use the virtual program. So we wanted to take the program virtual so that we can shift with all the demand and all the different social distancing laws that came into practice. So people can buy their tokens online and all they have to do is come to the restaurant. They'll just scan it and walk out of the restaurant quick and easy and making sure that they're not spending as long as they have to inside the restaurants. And with the platform, our scalability will actually keep going forward. We're making it so much easier for restaurants to join and even like reach out to us whenever possible.
Great, thanks. Maya Pearson from North Strategic has asked, what did you learn from your expansion to Ireland? And how quickly can you scale into other international markets? Which one's next?
Oh my gosh, I love talking about Ireland. The most exciting thing, I love it so much. Aoife has been an absolute pleasure to work with. So it's important to understand that when we're expanding, we don't just hop into any partnership. So we do a value assessment first and we set goals with our partners. So it all works a little different. So Ming approached us because she was really passionate about our project and she wanted to expand. But with Ireland, we saw the amazing work they were doing in Limerick with at-risk youth and training them financial literacy skills. We approached them, we told them our mission. And from then on out, we knew we were going to be perfect partners. We set goals and every time they met them and surpassed our expectations. So we are reinvesting all of our profits into the project. So we already have enough money to expand again, but we're not just jumping into everything straight away.
Great. David Henderson from XPV Water Partners has asked, can you break down the $619,782 of revenue by program and product?
Yeah, for sure. So when we look at that big revenue number, it includes all of our projects, of course. So we have the projects we presented on under the Square Roots umbrella, so what you saw in the video. Now, as far as that goes, most of the revenue does come from our bundle program. It is the biggest project. But outside of that, we also do have our youth and NOVA projects, which do bring in a lot of revenue in the form of government grants that we've received. So that's actually where most of the revenue would come from.
Thanks. Good.
Yeah.
Deanne Brise-Bois from the Retail Council of Canada has asked if you partnered with any other stakeholders during the pandemic, such as food banks.
So it's really interesting the network of communities that we're able to reach. So every community manager likes to do things a little differently. So one of our community managers one of the ones who moves about 2,000 pounds every week. He is actually part of already a food garden, which works towards getting food out to their community in a place called Sackville here in Nova Scotia. So it's so unique, and the model is different for absolutely everyone. We will never deny anybody who wants food from us, though, and any leftovers always get donated to the food bank.
We've also partnered with Wonder Bread. They reached out to us because they saw what we were doing and they wanted to contribute. So they provide us with 280 loaves of free bread to give out with our bundle donations every week.
Great, thanks. Erin Oliver from Modern Niagara is asking, can you explain who buys the tokens and where the proceeds go?
Right, so our tokens are purchased by, can be just about anyone, but our biggest target right now has been people in the low income sector and also students, because we realize that 30% of students are actually food insecure at the moment. So we have a lot of students from St. Mary's. We're working with people in homeless shelters, and with the program going virtual now, we'll be able to use the physical tokens to put them in shelters for free. So people can come and take the token, take them to restaurants as well. And the money that is generated is always coming back into the business to be reused for expansion, marketing, and so on.
Great. Jeff Wright from Canadian Western Bank has asked, why do you allow your franchisees to operate a little differently? Isn't a key to scalability standardization?
That's a great question. So for us, it's never really been about the revenue. It's never been about like pushing out as much as we can, as fast as we can, even though it's amazing to grow for sure. But the way we like to allow people to do things differently is that it allows people who don't have the resources to move 2,000 pounds of vegetables to also give back to their community. We're not picky here. If you want to help out your community, we love that and we want to help you do that.
Next question is from Brent Twist. Aside from COVID-19, what was your biggest challenge?
Aside from COVID-19, I'm going to say our biggest challenge this year would have to be, I don't want to say a challenge because everything is so exciting, but expanding into new territory is always an interesting challenge because I've never been to Ireland. I mean, I'm sure a lot of you have been, but not me personally. So it's kind of—
Your presentation time has expired. Judges, please join me in thanking the team from St. Mary's University. Thanks, guys.
My name is Sharon, and I've worked at this roastery for 10 years.
Tell me about the quality of Tim's coffee.
We have high standards when it comes to our beans. We reject one in every 10 containers.
No way.
We only take the best of the best. We only use 100% premium Arabica beans.
Do you think Canadians have any idea what's in their Tims?
I don't think Canadians know how high the quality of Tim Hortons coffee is. They only know it tastes great.
And finally, welcome the team from the University of Ottawa and their faculty advisor, Stephen Days.
Plastic is everywhere. Every year, over 300 million tons of plastic are produced globally, with only 9% of it ever being recycled. We waste nearly $9 billion worth of plastic annually, letting it harm our planet when it could be used for something valuable.
But we're supposed to have a solution to this. Isn't plastic recycling supposed to control and eliminate plastic waste? So then why is plastic that can and should be recycled piling up in our landfills and polluting our oceans?
At Enactus U Ottawa, we see problems like this as opportunities to use business principles and entrepreneurial leadership to create sustainable, positive impact. Today, we'll show you how we're taking control of the plastic waste crisis with Polly, an innovative social enterprise that allows anyone, anywhere, to take control of their community's plastic waste.
So here's how it all got started. To better understand the problem, our team spoke to community leaders, environmentalists, and experts on waste management, and learned all about the gaps in plastic recycling across Canada. And there are a lot. In cities with recycling programs, plastic is often discarded from the process because of something as small as a bit of food at the bottom of a container. Other cities don't offer recycling for businesses at all. And what's more, many communities around the world are simply too small or remote to sustain any recycling system on their own. Knowing this, we wanted to create a solution that made recycling more accessible and adaptable to meet the needs of every community. Something that was environmentally impactful, but also economically viable to ensure long-term sustainability. To do this, we decided to take the exact technology used in massive recycling plants and scale it down to fit into a garage, a workshop, or a community center. We spent 2 years researching, testing, and refining our machines, working with industry experts to develop our own small-scale recycling systems. And after 3 full product iterations and plenty of mistakes, this year, we finalized our machines. And though this is a project that we've been working on for a few years, our story today will focus on the impact we've accomplished this year. And this year, we grew our project at home and began scaling it across Canada and beyond.
Our systems consist of a shredder machine that shreds down plastic into small pieces, and an injection molder that takes those pieces, melts them down, and shapes them into new products using interchangeable molds. Our machines are small enough to be accessible, but large enough to make an impact. Each one of our systems can divert up to 1.5 million water bottles worth of plastic waste annually, all while using 99% less oil, 83% less CO2, and 97% less water than if that same plastic had been made traditionally. Polysystems can recycle 5 out of the 7 common types of plastic. That's PET, HDPE, LDPE, polypropylene, and polystyrene. Here's how it works. Polysystems are purchased, owned, and operated by local entrepreneurs, organizations, or municipalities. We work with our operators to build a social enterprise around their system, empowering them to create a profitable business that impacts both their community and the planet. We help them identify sources of plastic waste to collect, develop products that are relevant to their community, and design job opportunities, helping them build partnerships to make their poly system successful. To make sure poly itself is sustainable, we developed 3 revenue streams. The first is earned upon the sale of each system, which is sold for $25,000 at 25% margins. We then charge a consulting fee for training and on-site installation. And finally, as part of our ongoing support package, we offer a mold production service that operators can tap into to create new products. Operators can earn an average of $16,000 of profit per year by operating our systems, meaning they can see a return on investment in as little as 18 months. And for those operators that can't afford a system out of pocket, we work alongside them to secure funding through loans, grants, or leasing to get their operations off the ground.
So we had our system and we had our model, but we needed somewhere to start. And what better place to start than at home? Our hometown of Ottawa has a major gap in commercial recycling since the city doesn't offer recycling services to businesses. Last year, we launched a poly workshop in downtown Ottawa, started producing and selling home goods, and built corporate partnerships with companies like Lush Cosmetics and Old Navy, who throw away every plastic hanger that comes into their store after only using it once. This year, our team knew we could create even more impact. So we used our poly system to launch Evolve Eyewear, a social enterprise that creates eyeglass frames out of 100% recycled plastic. Evolve is a fully sustainable brand. Every set of glasses we produce are made out of 100% recycled plastic, giving it a second life and using less resources than traditional frames. We've built sustainability into every aspect of our operations and are set up to create fashionable frames for years to come. Through Evolve, our team also creates employment opportunities for individuals facing barriers in our community. We partnered with Lanark Community Programs to employ 12 individuals with a disability to clean and prepare plastics for recycling. We've also partnered with Christie Lake Kids, an after-school program for at-risk youth, where we employ 4 youth to help us produce glasses in our workshop, teaching them valuable technical skills. Our team works with all of our employees to provide training on topics such as resume building, personal budgeting, and how to earn trade-specific certifications. Evolve is giving these 16 individuals valuable training and skills that can help them achieve their goals and gain future employment.
I'm saving up for a Tuesday bass guitar so I can play it in the band.
I support Paris and Ewan. I support Garnett.
This work is actually at each person's level, and there isn't something that's too difficult for them to do. They can all achieve this. For us, like staff, very satisfying to watch them, you know, achieve sustainable work that they can do long term, and then also know that maybe they'll have the confidence later to get work in the community and that they can use this as possibly something for a CV or for a resume for later. I think that's a great skill for them to have, and it's part of the reason why this program is so great for them.
We've already had a successful round of pre-sales and are getting ready to launch full-scale operations this summer. We'll be selling our glasses via our e-commerce platform and in person at local markets, boutiques, and stores. This year, our team also developed a sustainability education program based on our poly system and piloted it to over 200 youth in Ottawa. The program is completely modular, allowing us to provide interactive activities to operators that want to use their systems for education. This year, we've diverted over 150,000 water bottles of plastic, tripling our impact from last year, all while saving over 140,000 pounds of CO2, 3,500 pounds of oil, and over 250,000 liters of water. Now that we saw what we could accomplish in Ottawa, we wanted to focus on scaling our business and helping others take action against plastic waste. This year, we're proud to say that we started scaling our project, bringing our state-of-the-art recycling systems to St. John, New Brunswick. Meet Luke, our first operator who received his system this February. Luke came to us because he wanted to start his own business recycling plastic that's polluting the coast of his hometown.
Plastic's a problem, especially here in St. John, and there's going to be a massive industry that comes up around this. There's going to be a need for people to operate machines like this to make products. There has been a lot of interest in the local community. The more people that see them, the more excitement there is. Just seeing products and then telling them about, you know, that's 100% recycled plastic. People go crazy. I've been asked to speak quite a few times, way more than I ever expected to. I have 3 different presentations booked like 6 months in advance right now. It's phenomenal.
Luke has been collecting plastic waste from local retail stores, helping to tackle the waste problem affecting St. John. He's using his system to start his own backsplash tiling business, providing a lightweight, customizable, and affordable option for homeowners in St. John. Finally, Luke is using his new venture to promote environmental awareness and education in his community, and hopes to create employment opportunities for individuals living in a local homeless shelter.
But that's not all. We also confirmed sales to Malone, New York, and Iqaluit, Nunavut. These deliveries were planned for this April and June, but due to the COVID-19 pandemic, they have been delayed. But our systems will be ready to ship as soon as possible. Our third poly system will be going to Malone Middle School in New York. When Jennifer, a teacher from Malone, reached out to us, the partnership seemed perfect. Due to their small size, the town lacks any official municipal recycling program, meaning that all of their waste ends up in the landfill. The staff and students at Malone will be using poly to divert this plastic waste and turn it into essential classroom items and art supplies. We're also working with Jennifer to adapt our sustainability education program, creating experiential learning opportunities in their art, science, and technology classes that tie directly into their poly system. We're also working with the staff at Inukshuk High School to bring our fourth poly system to Iqaluit, Nunavut. Here, plastics are rarely recycled because the city is too small and too isolated for a traditional recycling plant. And what's more, due to the high cost of shipping goods to the north, essential plastic products like child safety devices and school supplies can become unaffordable. With poly, the youth at the high school will be setting up a drop-off recycling program and using the plastic to create these essential products at an affordable price. We're also working with the staff to adapt our sustainability education program to fit the unique needs of this northern community.
Through these systems, our team has generated over $80,000 in revenue this year, and we're just getting started. Based on our current sales pipeline, we expect to have 8 systems operational in the next year. Ben from Omgenong First Nation will be using poly to produce reusable kitchenware out of her community's plastic waste, providing hands-on employment opportunities for those in need. David from Salt Lake City will be using poly to offset plastic waste from his furniture business and turn it into custom lighting fixtures. Andrea from Pipestone, Manitoba will be using poly to bring a sustainable program to the Kanapwakwa Dakota First Nation to create Indigenous-owned and operated recycling business. And Darren from Duluth, Minnesota will be using poly to set up a sustainable innovation workshop at the University of Minnesota. In total, these 8 poly systems will divert over 12 million water bottles worth of plastic waste, saving over 12.6 million pounds of CO2, over 250,000 pounds of oil, and over 23 million liters of water annually.
With Polly, we've created a business that not only empowers communities to take control of their plastic waste, but does so in a way that is economically viable, socially responsible, and environmentally sustainable.
But Polly isn't all we accomplished. This year, our team of 98 members contributed over 18,000 volunteer hours, ran 5 projects that generated real, sustainable impact.
With Project Fly, we've provided educational resources to over 500 students. We're running Legacy, Canada's largest student-run entrepreneurship conference.
And with Sprout, we provided access to fresh food for over 11,000 people in Ottawa food deserts.
This year, we saw a global issue that was destroying our planet and designed an innovative solution that empowers communities to turn plastic into possibility. This is Polly.
And we are Enactus U Ottawa.
Thank you, University of Ottawa. So judges, we will now take questions. I'm just gonna get the timer ready. Okay, so our first question is from John Florin from Methanex. How do the poly machines get serviced and repaired?
Yeah, so we've designed the poly machines to ensure that they are repairable and serviceable really no matter where they're deployed. First and foremost, when we actually go up to deliver the system to the community or the individual, we work with them and give them an extensive training and troubleshooting session, as well as supportive documentation alongside that. We also ship our systems with one of each critical replaceable part so that they have a backup just in case. Oftentimes, though, those products can be found in your average auto shop. Finally, we've designed the machine so that any small engine repairman can actually approach problems. And even if we're in Nunavut, there's at least one of those. So we're confident that we can ensure the stability of the systems.
Thanks. Wanda Randall from Canon Canada Inc. has asked, can you expand upon the variety of product molds you have currently available? And are there plans for expansion of those molds?
So one of the great things about working with plastic is that really the opportunities are limitless with what you can create. So far, we've been able to create tiles, different kind of household products, flower pots, things like that. We've also done some custom furniture jobs as well, kind of like covering those and doing commission pieces. But really, the possibilities are endless. At Malone, they'll be creating molds to make school supplies. We also see kitchenware, plates like that. Really, anything we like to say is as big as a small toaster can be made with the poly machines.
Thanks. David Henderson from XPV Water Partners has asked, how do you qualify your partners for the poly systems when they're not local?
Absolutely. One of the first things we try to do with anyone that's interested in a system is develop a relationship with them. We assign someone to our team as a bit of a case manager, and they're their partner along the way through the whole process of understanding what their needs are and how they'd like to use the poly system. So far, through building those relationships, we've been able to see universally that the values upheld by our potential operators are the same as what we see. And so as of right now, we see great potential with the operators we have. And at the end of the day, even if someone just wanted to run a very simple business with a poly system, they'd still be diverting a significant amount of plastic waste every single year, and we consider that a success.
Thanks. Jen McCain from Erie Capital asked, is there a recurring revenue stream opportunity like royalties beyond the sale of the system and the setup fees?
Our recurring revenue stream that we've implemented in our systems is based around the mold production service. So when operators are looking to create new products, they need a new mold for that. And we're experts at our own systems and what they're capable of, so we can help them along the way to get them the quickest and, you know, best costed mold possible. That's a recurring revenue stream for us and our operators. That's what we're currently looking into right now.
Great. Vittoria Varelli from Sobeys has asked, who typically purchases your recycling units? Businesses, municipalities, and what do they typically do with the recycled materials?
We've seen a very large variety as it stands to that. So far, Luke is an independent entrepreneur who's interested in taking recycling or plastic waste just from his community and turning that into the product for his actual business. We've seen other business owners that already have an established enterprise looking to divert one waste stream that they create and turn it into another sellable product in an environment like an institution or a school. Oftentimes that means maybe not selling a product, but replacing a product they otherwise would have to buy on an ongoing basis. So we've seen a great variety in the types of clients that are interested in poly systems. And I think that just kind of speaks to their applicability in a variety of different situations.
Fair enough. Jean-Francois from Scotiabank asked, you indicated that cleaning plastic was a major hurdle for commercial recyclers, but you didn't discuss how you overcame this challenge. Can you walk us through that?
Yes. So we've implemented cleaning as part of our operations, as part of the day-to-day, and it's also an area where we've been able to create sustainable employment opportunities for individuals that have disabilities. The reason it's not part of the recycling system is just based on the sheer scale of municipal recycling as we know it. These are machines that take up entire plants. They fill up what, you know, would be a regular apartment pretty much. And the infrastructure for cleaning that plastic is often just too expensive for that end recycler to get any value out of it. We are able to get value out of it, and we're able to create impact out of it.
Thanks. Jeff Cates from Achiever says it's a great return on investment for clients, but low dollars overall per year. Who's buying, and are they buying multiple?
So as I mentioned earlier, there's a variety of different types of clients that we see that are interested in poly systems. In terms of what we've seen, oftentimes we've seen a lot of cases where institutions, organizations are adding this as an extension to what they're doing. So a school adds it as an add-on, and it's not necessarily a primary source of revenue for them. The same can be said for the business that wants to turn plastic waste into lighting fixtures. That's an additional product revenue stream as a part of a larger whole. So that's oftentimes what we've seen, and those are often the most qualified and interested parties.
Great. Jamie Mackay from Align asks, can you tell us how you arrived at the $16,000 per year in profit from each poly operator? It's a pretty specific number, but we'd imagine it would depend somewhat on the products being created with the recycled plastic, would it not?
Yeah, absolutely. So we've developed that $16,000 number based on business models that we've been working with our operators and potential operators on, as well as things that we've seen here locally in Ottawa. So that number is based on gross revenues of $80,000 a year at 70% gross margins. And those margins are based on products we've sold here in Ottawa, taking into account $60,000 of fixed expenses, including a part-time salary for an owner-operator. And we also amortize those machines over 5 years. We think that's a conservative number. We expect the machines to last a lot longer than that. But nonetheless, that's how we come to that $16,000 figure.
Thanks. Kim Hallwood from HSBC Bank Canada asks, you mentioned that some of the deliveries would be delayed due to COVID. Are there any other risks or opportunities for your business that have arisen as a result of the current crisis?
Yeah, so the machines have been delayed, the two that we mentioned. In addition, though, we've worked with our suppliers to ensure that no other systems are going to be delayed, so we're avoiding those risks. But there have been some opportunities presented. We're currently in discussions with staff at the Ottawa Civic Hospital to identify personal protective equipment that we can make out of recycled plastic. We're finalizing those discussions, but currently it's based around things like face shields and whatnot.
Great. Gary Wade from Unilever says, I really like the applications for poly into low-cost glasses. Can you tell us more? Is this scalable, franchise, online sales?
Sure, yeah. So our glasses right now are sold online via our e-commerce platform, but we are working with a few local boutiques in our city to be able to expand into in-person sales. We also have a few partnerships in the works right now with a few major national optical companies that will be able to expand our sales across the country once it comes time to do that.
Great. Aaron Oliver from Modern Niagara asks, will you extend from molds to 3D printing in the future?
It's certainly something we're exploring. It is possible to create 3D printing filament out of this technology. We've just not seen that as something that our customers are immediately interested in, but we're definitely exploring that option.
Great. Karen Grieve-Young from Futurepreneur Canada has asked, for Evolve Eyewear, are you currently working with optometrists? Do you offer prescription or just fashion glasses, and will this evolve?
For sure, yeah. So in our whole development process for the company, we did work very closely with a lot of optical partners. And for the lenses, that's actually a company that we work with here in Ottawa that creates them for us. Our current plan of action is to start with sunglasses, but the frames are able to handle prescription lenses into the future.
Great. And Rob Henderson from Eureka asks, how long does it take and how much does it cost to build a poly system? And can that be scaled?
We've designed this project to scale from the very start. Part of what we wanted to do was create a solution to this really ubiquitous problem. And so scalability was paramount on our minds.
Your presentation time has expired. Judges, please join me in thanking our final team from the University of Ottawa.
Wow, what an amazing final round. I am very glad I am not on the judging panel. Thank you to our 5 finalist teams and our proud host of the Enactus final round of competition, Tim Hortons. Now, let's hand out some awards.